My name's Bill Fowler. A lot of people call me Bear. I've been fishing for 30 seasons now. Started in 1996.
Bill Fowler and his crew are prepping their boat Storm and Norman for a day of fishing on Lake Michigan. Fowler is a member of the Grand Traverse Band of Ottawa and Chippewa Indians and operates out of a tribal commercial fishing harbor north of Traverse City near Peshawbetown, Michigan. And for Native American fishermen like him, whitefish are both culturally significant and financially crucial. Fowler says fishing is not just a job, it's an escape.
I love to go on the water because it's going out there and leaving all the chaos behind. It's all on shore.
Whitefish have been an important food source going back centuries. And for decades, Fowler's catch has been served in northern Michigan restaurants. But in recent years, he's seen a dramatic drop in the number of whitefish he catches.
Years ago, the catch would be two-thirds or more. We still had good whitefish in 2010, 2012.
Sure enough, today, Fowler and his crew haul in mostly lake trout. They get maybe a dozen whitefish.
There's a whitefish.
Years ago, whitefish paid the bills, but not anymore. And Fowler's experience isn't unique.
Yeah, that's a good size one, medium.
Over the past 20 years or so, Michigan's whitefish harvests have fallen dramatically in Lakes Michigan and Huron, going from almost 7 million pounds in 2009 to less than 2 million pounds in 2024. What's causing the decline? Well, it isn't a mystery. And to get a little closer to the problem, I'm getting on another boat. This time I'm on the research vessel Nama with a team of divers and researchers led by Harvey Bootsma, a freshwater scientist at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. We're in Good Harbor Bay in Lake Michigan, not far from where Bill Fowler fishes. And the culprit behind the decline of whitefish is right below us. It's these guys, invasive quagga mussels.
The quagga mussels came from Eastern Europe in the ballast water of large ships coming from Europe to the Great Lakes. A couple interesting things to know about them is one is they're the great filter feeders. So one tiny mussel, you know, half an inch long, can filter a liter or a quart of water, if not more.
Since arriving in the lakes in the 1980s, the quaggas have multiplied. There are now quadrillions of them living on the bottom of the Great Lakes. That's thousands of trillions. And together, they can filter the volume of the lakes they're in a matter of days. So the water here is incredibly clear. And while it's beautiful, it's actually not a good thing for species like whitefish. The mussels have removed all the plankton and nutrients from the water, which gives it that clarity, but also means that baby whitefish are hatching into an environment where there is basically no food. The baby whitefish want to eat tiny organisms called zooplankton. But because of the mussels, there's just not much zooplankton left for them.
So they're swimming around like crazy looking for zooplankton to feed on, and they're burning more energy looking for food than they are getting energy out of the food that they're eating.
The result is that for years now, practically all the baby whitefish seem to be dying before they can grow up. So when the adult whitefish in the lake get caught or die of old age, there'll be no new generation of whitefish to take their place. That's a big problem if you catch whitefish for a living. And according to the Michigan Sea Grant, in 2020, whitefish made up 89% of the state's commercial catch and 95% of the sales. And that's why Harvey Bootsma and his team are here, monitoring and experimenting on the lake bottom. They're focused on two small plots that have been cleared of mussels, each about the size of a small house. The goal, to find techniques for controlling the mussel population. Step one, learn about the quagga mussels. There's some pretty basic stuff that we still don't know.
Do you have any idea what the lifespan of a mussel is?
You know, we don't. Not very well. I mean, they could live as long as 10, 15, maybe even longer years. So that's one thing Rachel is doing. She's tagging mussels to see how fast are they growing.
In my opinion, most accurate way to measure their growth rate is by tagging them, but not a lot of people do it because you have to keep pulling up the same set of mussels every time.
Step two, use what you've learned to bring down the mussel population. That part is easier said than done. The lakes are really big, and the infestation is serious. But we've dealt with invasive species before.
Where did this invader, the sea lamprey, come from?
Back in the 1940s and 50s, the invasive sea lamprey nearly wiped out the lake trout in the Great Lakes. But we've knocked down the lamprey population with poison, which we can do because they spend a lot of their lives in rivers. And we can treat rivers with a chemical called TFM, which kills larval sea lamprey while pretty much sparing other fish. But rivers are way smaller than Lake Michigan or Lake Huron. Could we use poison on mussels in the Great Lakes themselves?
Not that I know of. Some folks are looking at, for example, seeing if they can find a parasite that would be specific for quagga mussels that you could then perhaps propagate when introduced to reproduce in the lake and impact mussels at a really large scale. There also is some exploration of possibility of genetic modification of mussels so that they're not effective at reproducing. I think that both of those technologies are a fairly long way off from having any practical field application.
A mussel-specific plague would be really convenient, but the whitefish are running out of time, so these scientists are experimenting with some simpler technology too. This is the mussel masher, an 1,100-pound hunk of steel that, well, that mashes mussels. It's an effective way to kill quaggas in its narrow path. Trouble is, Lake Michigan is over 22,000 square miles. That much mashing just isn't practical. Plus, there's no clear data on whether mussels return to the area once the mashing is over. Also effective, smothering the mussels under dark, heavy tarps called benthic mats. They work by restricting the flow of water, which deprives the mussels of food and oxygen. They can also keep larval mussels from spreading. But once again, 22,000 square miles. Another idea is to buy time by moving whitefish to mussel-free inland lakes and ponds, where they would live for as long as it takes to ride out the mussel crisis. Then, in theory, when the mussels are in check and conditions have improved, we'd bring the whitefish back to the Great Lakes. There's no telling if it will work, but the Sault Ste. Marie tribe of Chippewa Indians has reported success raising small numbers of whitefish in ponds and then releasing them into lakes when they're a few months old. The idea is that by that time, they can eat bigger things, so the zooplankton shortage caused by the mussels is less of a problem for them. The big refuge for whitefish right now is Lake Superior, where invasive mussels are still sparse. Scientists think that's because the lake's water is low in calcium, which the mussels need to build their shells. The cold water might also hinder mussel reproduction, but even Lake Superior isn't completely mussel-free. Lauren Isbell is a biologist and diver with the National Park Service, and she's found outbreaks of quagga mussels around Isle Royale.
From what we're gathering, we're suspecting that they're just falling off of boats, like infested boats at this time. We do have one location on the island where we are finding smaller mussels, so that is indicating maybe a bigger problem, and we're not exactly sure if they're truly reproducing there or if larvae are being pushed in from another location and they're able to settle there in greater mass. We don't really know.
There is some hopeful news. First, while the mussels are still colonizing the deeper waters of Lakes Michigan, Huron, and Ontario, in shallower waters, their numbers seem to have stabilized or even decreased. It's way too little, way too late to mean the problem will solve itself, but it does hint at the possibility of a future with fewer mussels. Also, there's still plenty for baby whitefish to eat in rivers, and whitefish used to spawn there. If today's whitefish can be coaxed into spawning there too, instead of in the lakes, then their offspring might have an easier time surviving into adulthood. Finally, there's the round goby, an invasive fish that's made its way into all five of the Great Lakes. That's not great, but round gobies can eat small quagga mussels. When Harvey Bootsma's research team manually removed mussels from a section of lake bottom in 2016, the mussels didn't recolonize the site, presumably because the gobies ate them before they could. Of course, gobies also eat the eggs of native fish, including whitefish. So they're a mixed blessing at best. Still, a fish that eats quagga mussels seems like a promising ally. So the researchers on the Nama are trying to take a rough goby census.
So we lay the line out. It's a 20 meter long line. Lay the line on the bottom 20 meters and then a diver does a flyover over it. So your wingspan is 2 meters. So you fly over the 20 meter line and you count all the gobies within a 2 meter by 20 meter transept. You give us an estimate of the around goby densities on the bottom.
Obviously, more research is needed. And if the research uncovers a solution, it'll need to be implemented. All of that costs money, and money for science projects is far from certain right now.
We don't have our funding yet for this year, and we're not sure if we're the funding for this year. So we're still running on kind of the fumes from last year's funding, trying to stretch that out so that we can try to keep this thing going as long as possible.
The Trump administration has downsized federal science agencies that conduct and support mussel research, and there could be further cuts in the future. Meanwhile, the business of catching whitefish continues, at least for now. Livelihoods depend on it. Despite a dwindling supply of whitefish, Caleb Barrientos, one of the crew members working in Bill Fowler's boat, is optimistic about the future of fishing in the Great Lakes. He has a dream of his own, to open a brick and mortar shop to sell the fish he catches directly to consumers.
What I'm working for right now is not for me, it's for my kids. We can just be straight from the lake to the business that we'll own as well. So that's my end goal.